Okay, in the last lecture I have discussed about the cell-material interaction. So I'll continue with that, and then I'll discuss in this lecture on the in vitro testing. So different in vitro testing that is required to assess the biocompatibility property of biomaterials. Now, as you know, that biocompatibility is a core requirement or principal requirement for assessing whether a material can be used in the in vivo applications, or whether a material can be used for a given biomedical applications. So therefore, it is important to know more details that how this biocompatibility property can be assessed. Now, first thing that you need to know, that biocompatibility is system property. System property means if your material is biocompatible for a particular application, as I have mentioned couple of times during the last few lectures, that if a material is biocompatible, for example, in the knee replacement, that does not necessarily mean that the same material is biocompatible for heart valve applications, because your requirement is application specific, and therefore your property requirement is also application specific. That is the number one point. Number two point, for assessing the biocompatibility property, you need to do in vitro testing and in vivo testing. In vitro testing essentially means that when you are doing the tests in the laboratory simulated environments. In vivo testing essentially means when you do the experiments in the animal body itself or inside the animal body. Now, again, if a material from the in vivo applications, if a material is found to be good biocompatible in the rat model or rabbit model, that may not necessarily mean, or that may not necessarily tell you with guarantee that the same material will be successful in the human model experiments, because the in vivo conditions in the rat or rabbit is quite different from that inside the human being. Okay, because human actually is a large animal model, and in the large animal model, your fluctuation in pH, your fluctuation in temperature, or in that different type of collagen at different tissues, and their composition should be different compared to that the same thing in the rat or rabbit. So therefore, in before one material can be applied in the human body, it is important that you do the test right from the small animal, intermediate animal, right up to the human being before you can sell it into the market. So these understanding is important, and that is what I am saying here, that biocompatibility depends on a variety of system parameters, and it's essentially a system property. So if you change certain parameters in the system, then biocompatibility property also will be changing. Now, some of the things that I have mentioned here, one is the toxicology. Now, toxicology essentially means that whether a biomaterial is toxic to the gene or the DNA, or is capable of damaging the DNA inside the nucleus. Now, this test is part of the genotoxicity testing, which I'll be showing later. Now, biodegradation. Biodegradation essentially means whether a material can degrade itself in the biological environment. That means, so if a material before putting in the in vivo conditions, or before putting in the any animal model, has a certain set of properties like hardness properties, strength properties, etc., etc. Now, you put the same material inside a animal, and then after, let's say, 2 months or 3 months, you take out the material, do the test. Now, if you see that the material loses its strength, or the strength is decreased, that means there is a effect of the biological environment on the degradation of the material properties. So that is number two. Number three, design and construction. Now, it also depends that what is the shape of the biomaterial. For example, if the shape is very much circular type of materials, then you do not have any stress concentration at any of the edge of the biomaterial. However, if you have a very sharp edge like a square type of implant, that means these corners are the potential sites where there will be stress risers, or where the stress can be quite high. And accordingly, the implant, when it is used for the load bearing applications, the presence of these square corners actually will affect on its biocompatibility. Then implant movement. Now, implant movement is that, for example, your knee implant is an example of that implant which will experience, I mean, more number of movements compared to, for example, any other implants inside the body. our knee will take more load or more load or will take more load during its applications compared to any other material. So implant movement is also important, and later on I'll show you that how implant movement will cause the aseptic loosening. Aseptic loosening means whether how the bone or bone replacement materials or implants can be detached from the natural bone or can loosen out from the natural bone. Then surgery and sterility. Sterility is important, and typically the sterilization is done either by gamma radiation for certain materials or by steam autoclave, like, you know, steam treatment are typically at 121 degrees Celsius in water vapor. Chemical reactions to implant. Chemical reactions to implant means like whether a biomaterial leaches out some of the elements from its components, and thereby those leached out elements can cause certain toxic reactions in vivo conditions. The last one is that biological reactions to implant. Now, biological reactions to implant means, for example, when you put any material in the in vitro conditions, many times that in vitro environment or in vitro biological fluid can cause the hydroxyapatite or calcium phosphate rich layer formation on the material. And if it does, that is very good, because the presence of hydroxyapatite or calcium phosphate rich layer formation can induce more biocompatibility in the materials. So therefore, biocompatibility evaluation essentially will address or will focus some of the important properties that I have listed out here. Cytotoxicity. Cyto means cell, and cytotoxicity means cell level toxicity. Sensitization, genotoxicity I have already mentioned. Implantation means when you are putting the material as an implant in the animal body. So that is the kind of in vivo experiments. Carcinogenicity, whether the material can potentially cause the cancer inside the in vivo conditions. So therefore, testing of biomaterials or this biocompatibility assessment will try to address the following questions: that how to characterize the material that will be processed into a medical device on implant. So this characterization is more from biological characterization, remember. Second one, how biomaterials can be evaluated to determine if they are biocompatible. Now, if they are biocompatible, as I said, biocompatible is a broad parameter. So in the laboratory scale experiments, people do only a set of particular experiments which are part of the broad property which is known as a biocompatible. So if you do the cell culture experiments, you cannot say on the basis of the cell culture experiments a given material is fully biocompatible. You can only say on the basis of the cell culture experiments whether a material is cytocompatible or cell compatible. So that is, the cytocompatibility property is a much better description compared to biocompatibility if you use the word biocompatibility, right. Now, how biomaterials can be evaluated to determine whether they function appropriately in the in vivo environment. Now, again, as I have mentioned, that if a biomaterial passes through all the tests of the in vitro conditions, that even cannot guarantee that the same biomaterial can function very appropriately in the in vivo experiments, unless you carry out a particular set of in vivo experiments. Understand? So these things kind of bear in mind all the time as long as you are dealing with the biomaterials. So therefore, the question is that how biomaterials can be evaluated to determine whether they function appropriately in the in vivo environment. So that question is a kind of big time question, and then you need to address it very carefully. Now, testing of biomaterials, four phases. First one is the raw material characterization and screening. So raw material characterization means that what are the elements that you are using or what are the starting powders that you are using in the as a raw materials, and they are chemical, physical and biological characteristics or biological properties. Chemical properties means what are the elements that they contain, like calcium, phosphorus, silicon, etcetera, etcetera. Physical properties means what is the size, what is the properties. Biological properties means whether any of the starting material itself is biologically compatible or not. Then comes the material biocompatibility, and here this material biocompatibility, again I have mentioned that all the set of in vitro and in vivo properties, that is cytotoxicity, irritation, systemic toxicity, hemocompatibility. Hemo means blood, hemocompatibility means blood compatibility. Carcinogenicity. Carcinogenicity means cancer level toxicity or whether it can potentially cause cancer. Now, product and process validation. And product and process validation means like the way you prepare this biomaterial right from your raw material, that is important, and that depends on the manufacturing or sterility, finished product, etc. And routine testing. Routine testing means all the ISO standard testings. ISO means International Standard Organization. So ISO tells you that certain set of tests you need to do before you can release the product in the market. So all those testing needs to be done before this product can be marketable. Now there are two types of materials interaction. It is important that you know how this implant will look like or how the implant will react when it is put in the host. Host means here the animal or any human being. So here the implant is shown as the red rectangular slab. Okay. Now this is the doctors are performing the surgery. Doctors are performing the surgery here. That means the doctors are putting this red rectangular slab at the specific sites inside the human body. Now when you put this implant inside the human body or the any animal, then within T is equal to 1 minute. So you look at the time scale also, like what is the time frame along which these reactions form. Within T is equal to 1 minute, the biomaterial absorbs a layer of proteins. As I said in the beginning during the cell material interaction, that protein absorption is the first reaction or the first precursor before any further cell adhesion takes place. Now, within the first 1 minute or so that your biomaterial absorbs a layer of proteins, then cells means this is like fibroblast cells or macrophages. Now these are your cells. Okay. Now these cells actually come and get attracted towards the protein layer. And you know from your basic in vitro study that how this reaction takes place, like cell surface protein, they react with the adsorbed surface proteins on the biomaterial surface, and therefore these cells will get adhered to the protein layer here. Then fourth point is that cells fuse to form giant cells and secrete protein signaling agents like cytokines. Now cells, these giant cells means when number of cells they aggregate together, and this aggregation can be done in a self-organized fashion. Self-organized means cells will attach to themselves like in their own fashion in a self-organized manner, and they form a giant cells. And what they do, they secrete the protein signaling. Now this signaling process I have mentioned briefly in the last lecture, that signaling is important because through this signaling one cell will transmit the signal to the other cell, so that cell movement, cell proliferation or cell differentiation or cell division can take place during the in vitro conditions. And this signaling can be transferred, or these signals can go from one cell to another cell through ECM, that is the extracellular matrix. Now those things I have mentioned in the last lecture. Now in response to the cytokines, fibroblasts arrive and begin synthesizing collagen. Now what will happen once these giant cells form, then they send the signals to these fibroblasts, and because of this protein signaling, fibroblast means that is the cells of the connective tissue. And once these fibroblast cells, they are getting attracted towards this implant material, and that takes place during T equal to 5 days to 14 days, then what will happen? That within that time period, these fibroblast cells, they will arrive at the cell surface, near to the cell surface, and then they will secrete the collagen material. And collagen is important because collagen also will constitute, or collagen is a major component of the extracellular matrix. Okay. Then after that, the biomaterial is encapsulated in an acellular and collagenous bag. Now it is kind of, you know, that entire material is now contained inside the bag. Bag means it's like a, you know, it's a big bag which will contain the collagenous material as well as some cells and then protein molecules also. So entire biomaterial is now contained in a biological bag kind of things. Okay. So that is the way these two things, this entire foreign body reaction means FBR, that takes place towards the biomaterial. So essentially it starts with t is equal to 0 and it will go in the t is equal to 3 weeks. So entire process to take place, it takes almost like a 3 weeks or 21 days. Okay, and that is one of the reason that why many of the short term implantation tests to see that whether a biomaterial is biocompatible in vivo, that people do up to the 12 weeks, because your initial thing takes place even 3 weeks, then you see whether it causes inflammation to the neighboring tissues or the cells, and that entire thing should be studied up to a sufficient time period, and that is the reason it takes 12 weeks time. Now, if I can describe this, then you will understand it much better. There are two types of materials interaction. One is to create an inert surface and not allowing the absorption of proteins and adhesion of cells, and thus preventing activation of the immune system, blood coagulation, thrombosis, extracellular matrix deposition, and other interaction of the materials and the surrounding environment. So what I described, that what happens from t is equal to 0 to t is equal to 3 weeks, the entire process is not facilitated by certain material. So what they call as bio-inert material. Bio-inert means like it is biologically inert type of materials. Now, these kind of materials, the examples are like, for example, alumina or zirconia. These kind of materials, they cannot create a biologically active surface. They essentially create an inert surface, and they do not allow all this protein absorption, cell adhesion, and any activation of the immune system to take place. Now, examples are the heads and cups of the joint processes, intraocular lenses, and blood contacting devices. Blood contacting devices means like heart valves. Okay, so these are like blood contacting devices. Heads and cups of joint processes means you have the stem, you have the acetabular cup, and you have the femoral ball head. So femoral ball and acetabular cup, they do not essentially require this kind of tissue formation because they are essentially mechanical devices. So those kind of bones or tissues, they essentially do not require any kind of biologically active materials. So within the bio-inert materials also, if you use, that are perfectly okay. Now, this is the other, that is more general or advanced strategy, aims at creation of materials promoting attachment, migration, proliferation, differentiation, long-term viability, and cell functioning in a controllable manner. So that is the other biomaterials, that is called bioactive materials. And these bioactive materials essentially are the materials which belongs to the family of hydroxyapatite or calcium phosphate type of materials, and they are used at bone implants or some other tissue replacement applications. So these materials in the in vivo environment, they always create some surfaces which will promote the cell attachment or cell migration or cell proliferation. So these are the examples of the cell fate processes. Now these cell fate processes are essentially promoted or essentially encouraged when these sort of materials like bioactive materials like hydroxyapatite or tricalcium phosphate, they are implanted inside the animal body. Now cytotoxicity. Now in vitro cytotoxicity assays are essentially important to evaluate the toxicity of materials that can cause in close contact with living tissues. So tissues means these are like aggregates or the self-organized aggregates of the biological cells. And therefore, if the biological cells himself experience any toxic effect because of the material, then entire tissue also will experience similar toxic effect. Such materials may be toxic to the surrounding tissues under the action of body fluids or physical traces. Now, one thing that I must mention here, that typically cell culture experiments or cytotoxicity experiments in the normal biology labs or molecular biology labs, they do not involve any dynamic conditions. Dynamic conditions means they do not involve any flow of the fluid. These are called static tests. Static test means you simply put the material inside the solution and you observe the cell proliferation or cell attachment. But under the dynamic conditions, this cell attachment or cell proliferation behavior can be quite different. So on the basis of your simple static cell culture experiments, you can again cannot comment how this cell attachment or proliferation will take place under the dynamic conditions. So these are the kind of things that you should remember so that you can understand what happens in the entire process. The other things is the physical stress. Physical stress means when you are putting that any bone implant materials, so human body is not always in the rest condition, or people do not sleep 24 hours, right? So people sleep 8 hours and 16 hours in the working condition. In 16 hours, that entire things are moving, right, in the movement conditions. Again, under the physical stress of the movement, when the bone is under the movement conditions, then that will also affect the way cell proliferate or cell differentiate. Okay. So, but however, static tests again cannot tell you how these two factors, like action of the body fluids, like dynamic conditions or physical stress, will affect the cell compatibility or the biocompatibility of the materials. Now, in vitro testing. Now, cell culture solutions. So, these are like, you know, cells. So, these are like cells which are dispersed in the solution. So, let's say you take any animal, you dissect the tissue and you finally chop. So, this dissection of the tissues and chopping of the tissues essentially required to extract the cells from that particular tissue. So, if you are taking the connective tissue cells, then you can chop it and you can extract biologically the fibroblast cell lines. Okay. But this can be done in the laboratory, in the advanced laboratory, and normally all the researchers, they get the cells as if commercially in the growing conditions and the living state. Then the another thing is that you have to free cells from the extracellular matrix via digestion. So the cells also will be essentially dispersed in an ECM or extracellular matrix. But you want only cells, not the cells with extracellular matrix. So essentially you have to extract the cells from the extracellular matrix also, place them in a dish with nutrients and keep them warm. Now, warm means it is like 37 degrees Celsius. Now, you have to always provide the cells with a environment which will be sufficient for its survival. And sufficient for its survival means you have to give nutrients like food, like any human being cannot survive without food. Similarly, cells also will not survive without nutrients. And then second thing is that you have to give them physiological environment which contains 37 degrees Celsius, pH 7.4. So that environment must be given so that cells will survive. Okay, now this is a direct contact testing of the cytotoxicity, and direct contact means this biomaterial you can directly immerse and the surfaces are in direct contact with the cells, and then cells are in the solution, and this solution contains DMEM, phosphate buffer solution, on all those things. Okay. Then you can have this monolayer and confluent. So, monolayer means one layer, the surface will contain one layer which is full of particular cells, and these cells can be L99 mouse fibroblast cells. And again, these culture conditions typically can be 24 hours depending on the cell lines, and 37 degrees Celsius. Now, cells may change morphology, that is important. Cells may die or cells may lose adherence to the dish. Okay. So, what I am saying that there are three scenarios. One scenario is that cells die, like cells as soon as they come in contact with the material, cells will undergo apoptosis. That means cell death will occur, and that will essentially tell you that this biomaterial is toxic. So, that biomaterial is toxic effect. Number two, cells change their morphology. Change their morphology means essentially cells which are in free condition in the solution, they are like spherical shaped. Now, once it comes in contact with the biomaterials, then adhere, they spread, and then cells change their morphology, and that is very good as far as the cytocompatibility property is concerned. Third one, cells will lose adherence to the disc. So, sometimes what happens, you know, that dish type of that lower surface of that cell culture solution, cells will be freely suspending in the solution, but cells will not adhere to the material as such. At the same time, cells which are suspended in the solution, they are not dead. You understand what I am saying? What I am saying is that cells are surviving, cells will be dispersed in the solution, but cells will not adhere to the material itself. So, that shows that the material is such that protein adsorption cannot take place or cell adhesion process cannot be triggered. Okay. Again, those materials you cannot call them as a bioactive material. Now, in most of the cell culture experiments in the laboratory scale, people use L929, that is the mouse fibroblast cell lines. Now, this mouse fibroblast cell lines, why they are used? The answer is They are easy to maintain. This cell line is easy to maintain. Second one, people have found good correlation with animal test. Animal test means if you use the mouse fibroblast cell lines and you say that this material is in vitro cytocompatible, many times people have observed or people have reported that the same material is also in vivo biocompatible. That means it is more like one-to-one correlation. If it is having the good cytocompatibility with L929, it has good biocompatibility in vivo. The third point is that fibroblasts present in the wound healing process. Wound healing means like essentially when you are cutting some bones or joints in the human body and putting the implants, so you are essentially inducing some wound in the patient body. And in the wound site, the fibroblast cells are the first cells which will come, and then they will form some tissue in contact with the implant. So that is the reason that why fibroblast cells are used primarily in most of the cell culture experiments. Now, principles of cell culture. Cells can grow either in suspension or as a monolayer culture on a special surface. Now, monolayer cultures means most cells grow in monolayers with the exception of the hematopoietic cells, that is the blood cells. And third one is the suspension culture. Cells that can survive and proliferate without attachment. This ability is restricted to hematopoietic cells or cells from malignant tumors. So essentially what it means, that is the other scenario that I have told, that cells will not get themselves attached to the material, cells will still survive and they will suspend in the cell culture solution. Now, cell cultures are normally handled under the sterile conditions, and cell culture laboratories need to be equipped with incubators, sterile benches, autoclaves and all those things that you know. The other point is that various physical properties have to be taken into account to work with the cell, such as pH. Most cell lines grow well at the pH 7.4, temperature, viscosity, surface tension and foaming. Now, how this cell growth and proliferation can take place? So, tissue can grow by increasing the number of cells. Now, when you have been increasing the number of cells, then that process is known as the hyperplasia. Okay? Increasing the size of the cells, that is the hypertrophy, not atrophy. Increasing the amount of intercellular substances. So, when a cell will increase the cell size or will increase in size, that essentially means that increase in cell size must be accompanied by the increase in the amount of the intercellular substance. If the intercellular substance is not increased, then cells will not increase, will not be able to increase its size. An intercellular substance means like protein molecules. If they are transported from outside the cell body or outside the ECM or from other cells to the particular cells, then cells will accumulate more and more number of protein molecules, and then also it will increase in size. So, an increase in the cell number is by far the most important criteria in either normal or abnormal growth. So, what has been stated here, that when any process is accompanied by the increase in the number of cells, and that increase in the number of cells is important, because that will tell you that well, cells are in the growing stage or cells are proliferating first. Now, cell proliferation also or cell growth also takes place over the certain time duration. Now, this particular ACM micrograph tells you that what happens after 1 day, and then right hand side micrograph tells you that what happens after 7 days. So, at the end of the 1 day, L929 fibroblast cells, they are adhering, but the number is much less. But at the 7 days, the cells are adhering. At certain points, cells are forming some cellular network or cellular bridges. So, this you know that you know what is the meaning of the in vitro and what is the meaning of in vivo by now, and why that both the set of tests are important, and what is the necessity of the in vivo test as far as per se. Now, there are certain type of terminology that you should know. What is known as systemic effects. Systemic effects means whether a biomaterial when implanted inside the animal body, and that biomaterial causes some effect in the system which surrounds that biomaterial. And it can be acute like within 24 hours, it can be subacute within 14 to 28 days, and it can be subchronic like up to 90 days or more than 10% of animal's lifespan, and it can be chronic, that is more than 90 days and more than 10% of the animal's lifespan. So, what is means by that, suppose it causes some toxic effect, any biomaterial, and this toxic effect is seen within the implantation within the first 24 hours, then we can call it as a very acute toxic effect. Now, if that toxic effect is observed within 14 to 28 days, then it's called subacute toxic effect. Now it is called, if it is a chronic, then it is typically it is observed after 90 days, months, 3 months. And within the 3 months, if the animal or if the animal model will experience that any toxic effect, then it's called subchronic type of effect. Now host response, as I mentioned earlier, that host response means how the animal model itself will actually respond to the implant that you have put it inside that particular animal. So biomaterials in contact with human tissues may have direct or indirect adverse toxic effect. Now the various types of toxicity may be time limited and result. So this toxicity, as you have seen in the earlier slide, that it can be systemic, means this toxicity effect may not be seen immediately after the implantation. Like it may not be very acute. Acute means what you see within 24 hours. But it can be chronic also. Chronic means after long term, let's say 90 days, this toxic effect is seen. So then that type of toxic effect is known as the chronic toxic effect. And this, in case of the chronic disease or chronic toxic effect, that initially the implant may perform well, but you know, after 3 months, the implant may not perform biologically well in that environment. So that's why it is said that this host responses can be, toxicity may be time limited and result in minimal and reversible effect. Minimal and reversible effects, and maybe longer lasting, resulting in serious tissue damage. So serious tissue damage means that within long term and for a longer time interval and on a prolonged basis, that material can cause some tissue damage. So this slide has been explained before. Now the question is that why a biomaterial or why certain types of biomaterial shows or exhibit that kind of chronic disease or chronic toxicity after 3 months, for example. Now the answer is, in many times these biomaterials will experience some corrosion and wear in the in vivo environment, and the wear takes place after a long time and they generate some kind of particles. So that is what is mentioned here, that the wear particles may be released from the failed devices and are formed at the articulating surface of the implanted devices. And these wear particles, they are typically micron sized particles or can be nano sized particles. Finer the particles, more is the toxicity effect. Okay. So if the particles are nano sized, then it will have more toxicity compared to the particles which are in the micron sized. And the particles may also be injected directly into the body for clinical purposes. Now these are the standards in the biomaterial testing. This is like ISO testing, ISO, and which is approved by FDA. FDA is the US Food and Drug Administration, and ISO means International Standard Organization. Now they have this 10993 set of documents, and these 10993 documents, there is 1, 2, 3 like different subsets or set of documents. Like first one is the guidance on selection of tests. That tells you, like suppose you are trying to develop a material X for Y application. Now for this material X, what are the kind of test ABCD that you need to perform for to satisfy or to say that this material X will be suitable or will be ideal for this biomedical application Y? ISO 10993-1 will tell you that this you have to do test from A to D, or for example A to G. Okay. Then second one is the animal welfare requirements. Like, you know, suppose if you put this material inside a particular animal or human being, what is the animal welfare requirements that you must know? Those things will be mentioned in the 10993-2. Now 10993-3, that is the genotoxicity, carcinogenicity and reproductive toxicity, that is important. I mean, those test guidelines are mentioned. 10993-4, that is test for interaction with the blood, that is the blood compatibility test. 10993-5, that is a test for cytotoxicity, like in vitro methods. So all these tests are essentially tells you that what are the guidelines that you need to follow when you want to do a particular set of tests. Okay, we'll start with that 10993-1, that is the set of guidelines which will tell you that what are the tests that you need to carry out for a specific application. Now principles of the toxicity evaluation, that essentially characterize and identify the composition of the biomaterial and the potential impurities and extractables. Extractables means like when your material has a multiple composition X, Y, Z, Now, this you have to be judicious enough to understand that whether X will be leached out in the in vivo conditions, or Y will be leached out in the in vivo conditions, or the Z will be leached out in the in vivo conditions. And what are the impurities? Those will have this kind of effect. Second one is that account for toxic effects of the leachable chemicals and the degradation products. So, leachable chemicals and the degradation products. So, remember that these two things may not be the same, because your element can be leached out from the material, but then it can react with the biological fluid, then it can cause some kind of a product. So, that degradation product may have a different composition from what the element that is leached out from the material. Third one is that testing performed by competent and informed persons, so that is the medical professionals. And fourth one is the re-evaluate toxic effects if there are changes in the composition, manufacturing practice or intended use. Now, if you change your manufacturing process, means the way you have fabricated or you have sintered or you have compression molded or you have injection molded a particular material, if you change your process parameters, it is advisable that you need to revisit your all these toxicity studies again. Now, some generally recommended tests include cytotoxicity, sensitization or implantation test. Now, as I said that, you know, that in vitro cytotoxicity, or that is the cell culture test, that is under the guideline of 109935, and I'll quickly go through that, you know, what has been summarized in the last lecture. So, this toxicity actually affects, like, when this particular material, this is the hatched, is the material that is a biomaterial, it will release some kind of chemicals, and these chemicals can enter the material, inside the material. They can either be transported through the nucleus, then cause the DNA damage, or it can cause some death of these intercellular elements like mitochondria, Golgi body, Golgi apparatus. It can cause some damage, so that mitochondria cannot function like the way it performs in the normal healthy cells. Okay, so you understand what I am saying. So, you are essentially culturing the normal healthy cells on the biomaterials. Now, if the biomaterial leaches out some substances which can cause damage to the mitochondria, which produces the energy in the inside the cell, or which is the powerhouse of the cells. Now, if the mitochondria cannot perform the way it should perform in the normal healthy cells, and if it is damaged, that means cells also will lose its normal functioning. Okay. And essentially the cells will die over a time period. So, that means that cells is causing the toxicity effect in vitro, or if the material can be directly transported to the nucleus and then it has a toxic effect, then it can cause the genotoxicity or the DNA damage of the material. Now, this is the structure of the connective tissue and the tissue underlying epithelium. So, epithelium is the top surface or the top tissue, and here you can see that all the cells, eukaryotic cells, are connected to each other and in a very dense manner. So, that is what I have mentioned earlier, that in a tissue, cells organize themselves, and then tissue can be described as self-organized aggregates of the cells. Now, here you have a basal lamina, and here you have the macrophages. So, macrophages is another cells also type of eukaryotic cells, and you have the fibroblast cells, which has a different type of shape, which does not have the same shape as the cells of the epithelium. And this entire green stuff, as you can see, that matrix, it contains the ECM, that is the extracellular matrix. And extracellular matrix means it has also collagen, and it has the collagen as well as the hydroxyapatite particles and so on. And you have that all other type of cells like mast cell or capillary, etc. And this shows the collagen fibers. Now, this is called the connective tissue. So, entire connective tissue contains a number of cells. The other things that you should notice here, that these cells, they are kind of in direct contact with each other. However, all the connective tissues, these two connective tissues are not connected to each other, but they are separated by the extracellular matrix. So, connective tissues therefore have a different environment compared to the cells in the epithelium layer. Understood? This is the cells, how the cells which are surrounded by the ECM. So, this is the part of your this white background, or you know, white matrix. This is the part of your ECM, and you have the cell lines, like, you know, connected tissue cells and so on. So, this is the cell lines like fibroblast cell lines. So each, all the fibroblast cells, they are like separated from each other by the presence of the extracellular matrix. Now this shows how cells are surrounded by spaces which are filled by ECM. Now this is the part of one cell, and you have these fibers like structure, you can see these are essentially like collagen fibers. Okay. Now these collagen fibers constitute your extracellular matrix, and these fibers can be clearly seen, and some fibers inside the cells, do you notice, these are the cytoskeleton, that is the constitution of the cytoskeleton. Now this fluorescent image clearly shows you that what are the focal adhesion as the production sites for the intracellular signals. Now these focal adhesions are present at different sites in the extracellular matrix, and these are the collagen fibers which are constituting the extracellular matrix. So this appears as the green, and these focal adhesions means this is the points of the focal adhesions where the signals are generated, and signals can be transferred to other target cells through the extracellular matrix collagens. Now this is the anchoring junctions, and these anchoring junctions, they join the cytoskeleton from two cells in the epithelium, and these anchoring junctions are essentially, these particular junctions are called anchoring junctions, and these are the cytoskeletal filaments. Okay. Now what you see, that cytoskeleton filaments from cell 1, they are getting attached to the cell 2, okay, and then they form these black level junctions, and these black level junctions you can see here, which are considering, which are known as that anchoring junctions. Now the other things that you see, that is that you have this extracellular matrix ECM, now which is known as the labeled, and this is the yellow junctions which is just outside the this epithelium cell lines. Now this is the conditions that when the two cells are connected to each other as in epithelium, but when the two cells are separated from each other, like the way it is separated here, this is cell 1 and this is the cell 2, and this, you have this plasma membrane which is the cell membrane, and now you have the cytoskeleton filaments here, this green one, red one, and you have this intercellular intercellular anchor proteins, and you have also transmembrane proteins. Now there are different type of proteins, as you have noticed in the earlier lectures, like you have the proteins, the number of proteins can be as high as 10 to the 9 to 10 to the power 13 numbers. So this large number of proteins can be of different types. Now different types is protein is called trans, one is the transmembrane adhesion proteins. Transmembrane means they are essentially present between the two membranes, and they are essentially participate in the adhesion process between the two cells. Okay. Now this is mediated by this adhesion, and this is your actually intracellular anchor proteins. Intracellular means from one cell to another cell. It is helping in the anchoring process. So these cells are kind of called anchorage dependent cells, and the examples of the anchorage dependent cells are fibroblast cell lines. Anchorage dependent cells means like essentially two cells will be attached to each other by the intercellular anchor proteins as well as the transmembrane proteins. As you can see, that is like a forming a bridge between the two cells, and therefore the two cells will be attached to each other. Now other way that the two cells can be attached to each other is the joining of actin filaments from cell to cell by transmembrane adhesion proteins, that is called cadherins. Now this is cell 1, again part of the cell 1, and this is part of the cell 2, and you have these actin filaments here. Now these actin filaments, and you have these anchor proteins also. This anchor proteins is the blue one, and you have this cadherin proteins, that is the green one. So what happens, that cell to cell junction is formed here, which is established by these anchor proteins which are getting connected to the cadherin dimers. And you know that how protein complexes take place, because protein has certain anchorage sites, and through these sites the other proteins can be coming, can come together, and two individual proteins can come together and form a protein complex. So similar protein to protein junction is essentially developed between the cell 1 and cell 2. So this is the mechanism to illustrate that how cell surface molecules, the mediate. Now this is, there are three types of binding. It has been shown that one is that homophilic binding. Homophilic means this is the two same type of cells, and then from this one cell to other cell, the similar type of protein molecules or cell adhesion molecules, they come out and they make the bonding together. The other is called heterophilic binding. Heterophilic means like this is again two different cell lines, or it can be same cell lines, and then this is the one type of protein molecules coming. So if it is the protein molecule type X from other protein molecule type Y, they form, and they form a bond here. The third one is that binding through an extracellular linker molecule, like two surface proteins which are coming together, but they are not capable of binding to each other as such. This binding is essentially mediated by this positive, this plus molecule, and this plus essentially molecule from the extracellular matrix. Okay. So this binding here is mediated by the extracellular matrix molecule. So these are like homophilic binding, heterophilic binding, and then whether this binding is actually through an extracellular linker molecule. The statement that has been written here, that mechanism 3 is less common in case of mammalian cells. Like whatever biological cells or mammalian cells that you are using in the laboratory, or it is of relevance to the various biomedical applications, it is mostly the mechanism 1 or mechanism 2 which are mostly common or which are kind of dominant. Standards in biomaterials testing, that ISO 109-9314, that is the materials characterization. Now here you have to find out that what is the chemical, physical, electrical, morphological and mechanical properties of the materials that you are using. So most of these things, some of these things I have already mentioned that what it really means. Now mechanical test essentially means you can do the test either in tension, compression or bending, depending on whether you have a brittle material like ceramic or whether you have a ductile material like metal. If it is a ductile material, you can do the tension test. If it is a brittle material, you have to do the compression test or bending tests. Okay? And accordingly, you can calculate what is the elastic modulus, what is the strength, what is the ultimate tensile strength, etc. You can measure the fracture toughness. Now, this toughness can be measured from the simple tensile test from the area under the curve, or this fracture toughness can be measured for the ceramics by single edge V-notch beam, or putting the indentation, measuring the crack length and so on, and adopting certain equations. Now fatigue testing is also important, like for metallic materials, like you know you have the SN curves. So fatigue testing means when a material is under repeated stress cycle, what is the maximum stress level that the material can withstand before fracture. So when you do simple tension test means you have a material, you are pulling a tension from two ends. Okay? Now you are giving the uniform stress throughout the testing. But fatigue testing means you are not giving uniform stress, but your stress cycles are going like sinusoidal or cosine or whatever typical repeated stress cycle or reverse stress cycle, etc. And then you are trying to assess that what is the properties of this material under the repeated stress cycle. And typically, if your material is under uniform stress, then the material will have higher load bearing capability compared to the material which is under the repeated stress cycle or reverse stress cycle. So fatigue strength is much lower compared to your typical tensile strength of material. So that is the message that you should remember. Okay, now as this has been mentioned earlier, that these are the set of biocompatibility testing that one needs to evaluate here. Now genotoxicity, that is the next 5 slides I'll teach and before I finish today. Now genotoxicity tests are performed as tests in vitro to evaluate the risk of leachable substances on materials damaging DNA or causing mutations or chromosome damage. Okay. So that is the core idea of the genotoxicity test, and these are very important for pharmaceuticals as well as medical devices. Now what is genotoxicity? This is repeated here again, that is the toxicity effect in the chromosome, DNA and gene level. And genotoxicity comprises either mutagenic or carcinogenic processes, and these tests essentially screen medical implants and materials for its toxic effects at nucleotide for the safe and long term implantation. So what it means that in the long term level, this material should not wear out and produce some wear particles which will cause directly DNA damage. Okay? So that is what is essentially investigated here. Now why genotoxicity? To assess the effect of biomaterial eluates, to evaluate the size dependent wear debris particles, and third one, analysis of the physical and chemical basis of nanobio composite. So size dependent wear debris particle effect, as I mentioned to you earlier, that finer the particles, more is the potential for the particles to cause genotoxic effect. So if you are comparing the genotoxic effect of 10 micron versus 10 nanometer, 10 nanometer particles definitely will have more genotoxic effect compared to 10 micrometer particles. Now, this slide essentially tells you that, you know, the basically the concept of this genotoxicity effect. Now, you have this half of the cells here, and in the half of the cells, this is the nucleus, and nucleus contains this DNA. Okay. Now, DNA has a typical double helix type of patterns, and these double helix patterns, when it is exposed to biomaterial eluate, eluate means you have this wear debris particles which is in solution, like DMEM and the phosphate buffer solution, so on. So this entire solution is called eluates. Now, when this DNA is directly exposed to biomaterial eluates, what will happen? Some particles may damage these hydrogen bonds, which are essentially linking between two helix. And if the hydrogen bond is broken, that means you are essentially causing some damaged sites on the DNA. And what it will have, what this will lead to, this fragmented DNA. That means part of the DNA that will be immediately dispersed in the neighborhood of the DNA. So this is essentially caused by the debris particles. And I repeat, finer the debris particles, more is the chances of this genotoxicity effect. Now, what is the motivation for genotoxicity evaluation? Number one is the aseptic loosening of implants and periprosthetic osteolysis. Aseptic loosening means when implants are put it inside the animal, and then after long time, then implants can be loose, can be detached from the neighboring tissues of the bones. Periprosthetic osteolysis also is caused by the aseptic loosening. Third one is the apoptotic cell death at the implant site. So that is also another thing which will happen. Now, these individual particles, you can see these particles are coated by DMEM, that is the dimethyldoblucan medium, Eagle's medium, and this DMEM solution is actually coats preferentially all the particles. And if you see this micron bar here, these particles is roughly around 100 to little bit higher than the 100 nanometer. Okay. So essentially you can call it that ultra fine sized particles or almost like nano sized particles. Now, when you put these materials in the solution and then vary the amount of these eluates and then see that what is the DNA damage of the L929 cells. Now, this is the case for the control material and this is the condition of the L929 cells. Now, you don't see any damage here. But if you increase this concentration of these eluates here, now if you go to D and E, for example, in both the cases, what you notice here, that this is the fragmented DNA region which shows these concentrations have the genotoxic effect. And this is the positive control. Positive control means it is a reference sample which will definitely have the genotoxic effect. And that is what has been illustrated here, that it has a long tail. Now, if you take multiple images by the fluorescent microscopy, and then what you can do, you can measure the length of this tail, and this tail length is first proposed by a scientist called Olive. And accordingly, this is known as Olive tail movement. This is OTM. Now, if you measure this OTM for different conditions and put it in a graph, what you can see here that if this particular concentration more than 25%, they have a statistically significant genotoxic effect, and the positive control has a much more genotoxic effect. So, this is the OTM, that olive tail movement for this particular biomaterial eluates. So, I think I'll stop here, and in the next class, I'll start with the blood compatibility.